Thank you for coming, people I know very well and new people. My name is Elsie Armstrong Rhodes. I was a student here 78 through 1982, and I am sharing with you less information and more conviction. So I want to start out by saying that this is personal. It's personal because for me it relates back to my faith. Is it easier if I use the microphone, or can you hear me? I'm a Presbyterian pastor, and I live in an area of New York, in central New York, in Cooperstown, New York, where there was a very strong grassroots movement toward anti-fracking. And I first became aware of the issues around Standing Rock because of the connection to the environmental issues. And so I started reading articles. I have electronic files on my computer, and every time an article came, if I didn't have time to read it, I would file it. So I have hundreds of articles about Standing Rock. It went from becoming an environmental issue and concern for me because of the concern for the people to concern about, there was a program on environmental racism. I didn't get to hear that one, but I think this is an example of environmental racism, what was going on there. Centuries, how white people have treated indigenous people and people of color. So the challenges in Standing Rock took on other concerns for me. And I think I was just waiting for an excuse to go to Standing Rock. And in December of 2016, you all may recall, if you were following the news, there was the iconic images of the water, people being doused in water in freezing temperatures, and the dogs, and the gas, and the tear gas, and the stories about that. But then in December, they were given the order that everyone had to leave the camps by Monday, December 5. And you may have heard about the Veterans for Peace and veterans who traveled from all over to stand with the water protectors. They're called water protectors, not protesters, water protectors. And I read an email about December 2nd, about a colleague of mine, a Unitarian Universalist pastor in Oneonta, which is about 22 miles from Cooperstown, read a brief report that he was on his way to Standing Rock, that there was a call for pastors. I didn't do any research on that. I didn't know why they were calling clergy. I said, okay, I'm going. And in my Presbyterian system, typically a clergy will go to her governing board, her session, and ask for permission. I didn't even ask for permission. We had already had a conversation earlier. Yes, there are exciting things happening next door. I'm fed by that energy. My session and I had already had a conversation about taking our faith into the streets. And so I wrote them and I said, I'm asking for your blessing, not your permission. I have 3 days that I can do this. It was right in the season in the liturgical calendar of Advent. there's a call for clergy. I don't know what they need, but I will go. And then I called a clergy friend of mine from Minnesota. I knew he had gone to Standing Rock and asked him, should I go? Is this such, again, a white privilege person who just goes and here I am to save the day? I don't want to do that. And he talked me through it and he said, well, no, you don't want to do that. But if you go, and you have to make your own decision about this, realize you are going to say, I stand in solidarity with you, and I'm here, and I want to witness. I want to be a witness. And I want to take back to my community, and I'm from New York State, and I'm traveling to North Dakota to witness so that I can say to my community what I saw. He said, if you can do that with integrity, I think you can go. And got plane tickets. This was in 2 days. I got plane tickets, figured out a friend who could go with me. She went with me. We didn't make hotel reservations. Just figured we'd sleep in the car. What did I know? Someone said, make sure you don't put any burden on the community there. So make sure you have a sleeping bag and warm clothes and take provisions. And then I was sent a 12-page document, which I've highlighted to share some things with you from it, that gave really good counsel about it. If you're a white person, be quiet, listen. As white people, we do so much talking, especially external processors as I am. You are not, you're there to listen, you're there to witness. And realize that stepping into another culture is stepping in open, with an open heart, an open mind, an open spirit, an open imagination. The people there at Ocheti Sakowin, and that's the traditional name for the Sioux. And it's also the name of the largest camp there. There were at least 3 or 4 camps in Standing Rock. And Ocheti Sakowin means, it translates as 7 council fires. 7 council, I'll make sure I'm right there. Let me make sure I'm telling you the correct thing. 7 council fires. When you go there, realize that their life there, the way they understand life is all of life is a prayer. If you're going with violent intent or aggression or I'm going to show those militarized police, no, you're not in a prayerful space. The people there are nonviolent. On the camps, no alcohol was allowed, no drugs were allowed, tobacco was allowed. In fact, tobacco was part of some of the ceremonies there. No cursing. They saw all of life as sacred. So this, what impelled them and what impelled me to go there was a sense of stewardship, of caring for the water, caring for the people, a call to be responsible for all parts of creation, which is why they were nonviolent and prayerful. So I came upon this trip out of a sense of faith conviction and And what I took away from the trip was, even with that desire to be a witness and to be in solidarity, to stand with them, I discovered again my own hubris, because I was still going thinking I could give something. And we ended up getting there as the blizzard hit. We arrived in Minneapolis. We were going to, and we did, rent a car and drive to North Dakota. And we heard on December 4 that the news that they would stop the work on the pipeline. There was President Obama's action, and then the Army Corps of Engineers said, stop the work on the pipeline. And there was some celebration, but everyone knew that was temporary, that it would return with a new administration. But when we got there, we drove through the night from Minneapolis, and we arrived on Monday morning. The snow, there were 50 mile per hour winds. I had no idea how I would survive that, and I became needy. We stayed overnight in the car in the camp, and gone were any wonderful notions about being a witness. I was in my car for 13 hours. We didn't leave the car in the camp. We were frightened, not for our safety, but for, I mean, because of any human beings, but the elements. So I discovered my hubris, and what was I thinking? I could just come here and be a witness. And I discovered humility as we experienced the hospitality of people there. The veterans who had arrived, the people who had lived there, there were close to 10,000 people at that camp. Kitchens, there were about 11 kitchens. The supplies that people brought, the people built a school there for the children. There were yurts and teepees and a wonderful geodesic dome. If you see pictures of course, all of this is gone now. You know, they burned the camp, but in December, if you see any pictures, photographs from that time, you'll see this geodesic dome. In our car where we stayed was just a few yards from that, but discovered the hospitality of the people. We ate with them, we volunteered in the kitchen. We didn't stay long at the camp because of the blizzard. They were encouraging volunteers who were not set up for the winter to move on, so we didn't stay there long. But that's a little of my personal background. And I wanted to show you some photographs, images that I've collected, a video that I found, and then at the end, if I can figure out how to do it, I wanted to show you my own video footage that I put on my Facebook that somehow I hope I can put on the big screen for you. May I interrupt just to say, is there anyone who has been to Standing Rock who's in this room? Oh, I was wondering if there'd be anyone from the university who had been there, but so let me show you some pictures. Can you see from this how far back the people go? There were representatives, I am told, from over 500 tribes throughout the world. This was the first time ever that the numbers of people representing 500 different tribes around the world had ever gathered. This Standing Rock, the challenges to this community inspired and compelled a movement that was worldwide. And you may have seen in some of the stories, the world is watching. The world is watching this. This wasn't just about this community. This touched on so many issues. Again, I chose this image because of the masses of people. The concern about the pipeline there, the Dakota Access Pipeline, DAPL, energy partners, it's a corporation that's behind this. The concern about this pipeline goes back to 2014. Originally, the plan was to put the pipeline, it was near, supposed to be near Bismarck, and the people of Bismarck protested that move. Bismarck is 90% white. They moved it. People around the world have protested this. And as you know, work has restarted on the pipeline. Environmental racism, as far as I'm concerned. And this, I chose this picture at the height of the violence that was coming from, that was ordered by the governor, and then, I mean, the governor was played a part in militarizing the police. Police came not just from the local areas, but from all over. And when I was there and what I have read and seen, the people at the camp, the water protectors and those called there to protect the water protectors were unarmed. No weapons were allowed on the camps, at the camps. So you get a sense of this, of the resistance, but it was a nonviolent resistance. This was one of the iconic images. November 4th, it was cold. It was freezing. And the water cannons. So I'm going to play a video for you, and I'm not presenting a balanced view here, okay? I feel very strongly about this, so the video I chose is also has a certain viewpoint about this.
Line in the sand and say the same. us do of our sons and daughters.
I wanted to share with you, you may have seen this article, this piece by David Archibald II. So David Archibald II is the chairman of the Standing Rock Sioux tribe. He was arrested in the summer. He wrote this piece for the New York Times. I just wanted to highlight some of what he said. He said, "It's a familiar story in Indian country. This is the third time." Do it. "This is the third time that the Sioux Nation's lands and resources have been taken without regard for tribal interests. The Sioux people signed treaties in 1851 and 1868. The government broke them before the ink was dry. Whether it's gold from the Black Hills or hydropower from the Missouri or oil pipelines that threaten our ancestral inheritance, the tribes have always paid the price for America's prosperity. Protecting water and our sacred places has always been at the center of our cause. Our hand continues to be open to cooperation, and our cause is just. This fight is not just for the interests of the Standing Rock Sioux tribe, but also for those of our neighbors on the Missouri River. The ranchers and farmers and small towns who depend on the river have shown overwhelming support for our protest." You all know that there are oil spills. If you just Google oil spills, you will be there for days reading articles about oil spills. And so when the water is contaminated by oil, that's it. So it is obviously an environmental concern. So he said that the tribes have always, as American citizens, we all have a responsibility to speak for a vision of the future that is safe and productive for our grandchildren. The Native Americans and indigenous people speak in terms of seven generations. They are always in their mindset, in their heart set, thinking of many generations beyond this moment. It's a different worldview. "We are a peaceful people, and our tribal council is committed to nonviolence. It is our constitutional right to express our views and take this stand at the Cannonball Camp. Yet the Lieutenant Governor of North Dakota, Drew Wrigley, has threatened to use his power to end this historic peaceful gathering. We are also a resilient people who have survived unspeakable hardships in the past, so we know what is at stake now. As our songs and prayers echo across the prairie, we need the public to see that in standing up for our rights, we do so on behalf of the millions of Americans who will be affected by this pipeline. As one of our greatest leaders, Chief Sitting Bull of the Hunkpapa Lakota, once said, "Let us put our minds together and see what life we can make for our children." That appeal is as relevant today as it was more than a century ago. And this was published on August 24, 2016. We were privileged to be able to participate in a prayer ceremony, our first morning there at Standing Rock. We were in one of the kitchens because that was one of the few warm places, and that's where my friend and I were volunteering. I helped make a potato salad, and I served oatmeal, and I loved that. I loved the opportunity to be able to greet. That was the veterans' tent, so to greet a lot of these veterans who had come to stand with the people of Standing Rock. And then there was this very moving prayer ceremony. And part of the prayer ceremony was, it always involves fire, and I was given some cornmeal to hold at the entrance of the tent. So as people prayed and then left to take their prayers outside and pray for the world, they took some cornmeal. And the person who gave that to me to hold didn't know I was a minister. But I said to him, "Thank you, you don't know what this means to me." He just, no, I was, again, making it all about me. But anyway, it was so moving. I feel in my own spirituality, it was expanded by seeing how their sense of no separation. So if the animals are crying out, that's a member of the body. If the enemy is crying out, that's a member of the body. That strengthened my own spirituality. Before I show you a last video, do you have comments, questions? Yes.
How far was the camp from the reservation?
It was on the reservation. The reservation stretches from North Dakota to South Dakota. And the camps were on the reservation.
So then how could the governor call in militarized police?
Yeah.
That's the point.
It's an independent nation.
Right. That's the point. Thank you. Preach it. The treaty, as he said, they violated the treaties before the ink was dry.
Very sad.
So what I'll show you now, and close with that because I talked too much. So this ceremony, Wesley Clark Jr. made a public apology before the tribal elders. And this was the Monday that we were driving in. So I told you we didn't stay at the camp, but 30 hours. We were told to get as far away as we could from the storm. So we didn't make it beyond 7 miles from the camp. We went to the casino that's close by, Prairie Nights Casino. And Prairie Nights Casino, the rooms were all full, and then 500 people were there taking shelter. And that was the best night's sleep I had in this big, it's like an expo room, 500 of my closest friends sleeping together with our sleeping bags. And but we were safe, we were warm. It was, so this was Tuesday night. We arrived Monday afternoon in the storm, stayed Monday night, were there Tuesday helping out, and then we brought some supplies. Then that night we were in this expo hall, and there was a 5-hour ceremony, stories, drumming, dancing, and I was just lulled to sleep. I wanted so much to stay awake, but I was so tired I just went to sleep. But part of that ceremony involved the veterans and the tribal elders, and they handed out feathers to each of the veterans. And this was what I just described, was after this public apology. So the spirit of reconciliation and forgiveness was still in the air. And this is so moving. You probably saw this. This was on YouTube. But I would love to close, because this is hopeful to me, even though they're beginning work on the pipeline, to learn from a people about forgiveness and not returning evil for evil, but being prayerful and yet resistant. On March 10, there will be a march in Washington in solidarity for Standing Rock, because this resistance is just beginning. And it affects all of us. And I think if we can learn from the Lakota, the Dakota, all the people who see life, all of life as a prayer, just think how different the world would be. So this is an example of that.
Beside trees that we broke, we stole minerals from your sacred hills. We blasted the faces of our presidents onto your sacred mountain. We took still more land. Then we took your children. And then we tried to take your language. We tried to eliminate your language that God gave you, that the Creator gave you. We didn't respect you. We polluted your earth. We hurt you in so many ways. We've come to say that we are sorry. We're at your service. Thank you.
People who were in the room and said it was life-changing. So thank you for your attention. and peace be with you in my tradition.
Are you going to take questions?
Well, I opened it up for questions. Do you want some more?
Where does Standing Rock stand now?
They were ordered to leave the camp by 2 o'clock on February 22nd, I believe it was. And a number of, at that point, there were 300, when that order came, there were about 300 people left at the main camp, Ocheti Shakowin camp. And you know what I said earlier, at one time there were 10,000 people there. That was when the volunteers came and the reason the veterans came, do you remember the reason the veterans came? Because they were expecting this big standoff on December 5 when they would be asked to leave. They were going to be forced off the property, and so the veterans came and they were going to protect, they were protecting, be the bodies in the way to protect the water protectors. And I learned when I got back the reason there was the call for clergy, and it was specific clergy. Had I heard this, I wouldn't have gone. They wanted clergy who had an experience in trauma because they felt that the when the veterans faced off with the militarized police, it might trigger some PTSD. So they wanted the clergy, there were 30, 31 clergy, my friend was one of them, there to be of support and assistance should that happen. And then it was called off, so what ended up happening, a lot of those veterans then volunteered at the camp, they were building, they were preparing for winterized living there. So they built a school, they built shelters. A number of them went to the Prairie Nights Casino to help with serving food and cleaning up when that became a shelter. So that was when there were all those people. Volunteers were encouraged to leave because it was really a burden on the people who lived there full time, who had made that their home, the camps their home. So it got down to about 300 people left, and when they got the order to evacuate by February, I think it was February 22nd at 2 p.m., many left voluntarily. But some resisted and were not going to leave until they were forced off. And what they ended up doing, many of them, they burned their teepees and yurts as, again, a sign of resistance. They, the people who were living there, not the police. There, you can go online and Google that. There's some amazing film footage of people who were there to the very end. So to your question, where things stand with Standing Rock, lawsuits, DAPL, suing DAPL, and actually there are larger lawsuits. There are people in my denomination, the Presbyterian Church, who our local church gave money to the Synod of Lakes and Prairies, which is the larger governing body in the Presbyterian Church in that area. And the money going there will help in the suits, suing DAPL, but also the government, to your point. There are people at work there. So it's in the legal realm. That's one aspect of it. And then it's raising education. There's still these pipelines. Now, I drove here. I drove from Cooperstown to Princeton. So I'm not guiltless here. I was using gas, fossil fuels. But I would love for there to be more money, more energy put into alternative energy. I would love that. And I hope I can be part, I can take the stand and live differently. Now I'm getting much better about recycling, but still. So there are those issues. And the march on March 10 is, again, the solidarity, the there's a lot of education that needs to happen, eyes open to...
Were you aware of signs of poverty?
You know, the interesting thing, when you're on the reservation, you're just seeing this amazing landscape. And one person wrote about Standing Rock, her experience there. She was there for a couple months, a white woman, and she said, I learned about gift economy. Yes, sorry.
Oh, sorry. I was just wondering while you're there, did you speak to any of the people from the tribes about faith or like your own faith?
Wouldn't that have been wonderful? You know what? I was so frightened of the freezing temperatures that I missed out on going into the sacred fire that was burning. It never went out. There was always someone keeping watch over the fire for months, years. I mean, there were right there, and that could have been a place to hear those conversations. When I was in the kitchen tent, the conversations were very practical about making, preparing food. And then when we made it to the casino, we were talking with other volunteers about their experiences there. So I wasn't there, unfortunately, long enough to have any of, to listen to any of that conversation, although I met people who did. You know, this was a youth movement. This started with the young people who took it the next step, who got the word out, who gathered the people, and that's inspiring. I mean, there's so many pieces of this story that are inspiring. So it was more from what I read than actual conversations because of the blizzard. It's a great question. Thank you. Sorry to, oh, Mike?
This is closer to home also. I don't know if you folks are aware. There was a pipeline through the Pinelands that was bought and just approved by the Pinelands Commission in South Jersey. There's a natural gas pipeline that's proposed to come through Central Jersey right here. And there's some movement that's underway to try to not have that happen either. There's a natural gas pipeline that's scheduled to come right through Trap Rock and Kings Mary here and go up through Somerset. So there's a natural gas compression station that is being proposed about 12 miles from here to increase the pipeline capacity. Every dollar that gets spent on more carbon infrastructure makes it that much harder to stop, because then there's just more sunk money in it. So there are things that you can do right now that would have an impact on projects that are being proposed right now.
And there's, yeah, absolutely. And back to the DAPL, there's a whole list of banks that are supporting it. One bank actually pulled out. But if you have any investments in those banks, that's one way you could take out your investments. I don't mean to be so glib about it, but there are different angles. And yes,
it's easy to find. If you just Google Central Jersey Natural Gas Compression Station, it should come right up.
It's also the Pilgrim Pipeline flows up in Ottawa, and there is, it's crossing Indian land there as well.
Yeah.
Kind of an equivalent to Standing Rock, a smaller scale, but that's going on right now in northern New Jersey.
Yeah, thank you. That's right.
Elsie, tell the story.
And I mean, the sign is the hospitality of people, the hospitality, making sure that everyone was taken care of, whether it was gas someone needed or a ride someone needed or food, or everything was taken care of. There were people who were young people who took turns. They were called sentries, and they were on horseback, and they rode around the entire camp through the night. And there were people who, three people who were hypothermic, and they found them. There was one person who was wandering, it was lost, and they found them and took care of them. There was a medic tent. There was, I told you about the school. There was a place for if people needed counseling. I mean, people just showed up with their gifts. They just showed up, whether they were the gifts of food or stoves or wood or, and nothing was wasted. I mean, there's a whole article. I was going to share excerpts with you of the, how they used everything, even the plastic bottles that people left. They put them together in a bag and used them as insulation. Tarps that people left behind, they used the tarps for the yurts they were making. Nothing was wasted. I mean, I could learn so much about that new kind of economy. So,
are you glad you went?
Thank you. Yeah. Yes. But sometimes you go with one idea and you come back having learned something very different. So absolutely, absolutely. And I hope if this has done anything to encourage you or change, either affirm something you already believe or change your mindset, that's worth it. That was worth the trip. I hope I can be true to being a witness. So, thank you.